Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel Anatomy by Dr. Vijaya. Today's video is about development of external genital. As I have done my previous video on development of urinary system and the development of female and male reproductive system, so it didn't include the external genital. As I mentioned that it will be done in a separate video. So in my previous video on female and male reproductive system, I had mentioned that genetically the sexual differentiation can be done at the time of fertilization, which is genetically, but morphological characters do not start developing until 7th week of intrauterine life. So during this early stage, that is before 7th week of intrauterine life, both morphological characters look similar, both in male and female. So this stage is called as indifferent stage or ambisexual stage. And once the primordial germ cells migrate to the intermediate mesoderm, there will be further development of the gonads. So it totally depends upon the chromosome, the primordial germ cells which are carrying the chromosome. So if it is carrying the XY chromosome, the Y chromosome will be having a particular gene called as SRY gene, which encodes for a factor called as testis determining factor. So this will help in the further development of the medullary area of the gonadal ridge, okay, which will later will form the male genital system. And if there is XX chromosome, since there is no Y chromosomes, so there will be further development of the cortical area of the gonadal ridge, which will lead into the formation of the female gonads. So this stage, ambisexual stage, and the also called as indifferent stage. So once the gonad develops, so the hormones which are secreted by these gonads will influence in the further development of the duct system, male and female duct system, and also it has an influence on the development of external genital system. Okay, so we will go further in detail about this development of external genitalia. If you can remember the process of gastrulation, where there will be formation of primitive streaks, so this basically happens during 3rd week of intrauterine life. Okay, so if you can remember this picture, you can go back to my video on 3rd week of development for more details. So if you can see the primitive streak, there will be formation of primitive streak, and it stops at a area where the primitive node is formed. Okay, and this mainly formation of primitive streak helps in the migration of a formation of three germ layers, that is the ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. So the epiblast, some of the cells from the epiblast, they form the separate layer called as mesoderm. So those mesenchymal cells, they start migrating throughout the area of the embryo. Okay, so you can see here they are migrating. These arrows are showing the migration of the mesenchymal cells, and these mesenchymal cells are mainly not seen, especially at the midline from the area from the primitive node. Okay, so this is the area where the notochord is formed, which will mainly influence the overlying ectoderm to form the neural tube and the neural plate and the neural tube formation. Okay, so at this particular area there won't be migration of mesenchyme, and other two areas is one at the cranial end where the precordal plate is formed, the other at the caudal end, which is called as a cloacal membrane. Okay, so this cloacal membrane just has the ectoderm and the endoderm. Okay, so around the cloacal membrane, the mesenchymal cells, they migrate and they form a fold around the cloacal membrane. So this green structure represents the cloacal membrane, and the mesenchymal cells which are surrounding around the, which are migrated and they are around the cloacal membrane, so that forms a fold called as cloacal fold. So external genitalia of both sexes, they remain undifferentiated till the early part of the development. So once there will be formation of gonads, so in male it's a testis. In female, it's the ovary. So once they are developed, they influence the hormones which are secreted by these gonads, will influence in the further development of the female and the male duct system, and also male and female external genitalia. So the sex differentiation of the external genital organs, so they become apparent mainly during the third month of fetal life. Okay, so during the in different stage, that is, as I mentioned earlier, at the third week of development, the mesenchymal cells in the region of the primitive streak, that which migrates around the cloacal membrane, so they form an elevated folds called as cloacal folds. Okay, so there will be formation of a pair, that is the on either side of the cloacal membrane. So you can see over in this picture here, so this center part is the cloacal membrane, and the mesenchymal cells which have been migrated on either side, okay, so they form the cloacal folds. So these cloacal folds, cranial to the cloacal membrane, so they fuse to form a tubercle called as genital tubercle. Caudally, these folds are separated, so the fusion is only at the cranial aspect. So here you can see the pair of cloacal folds. So later, these cloacal folds, they are subdivided. As you know that cloacal membrane are also subdivided by a layer of septum. So this, even the cloacal folds are subdivided. The one which is around here, so the anteriorly, the fold is called as urethral folds, and the fold which is at the posterior aspect will be called as the anal folds. Once the cloacal membrane divides, if you can see here, this is the cloacal folds, this is the cloacal membrane. So the anterior most aspect is the urethral folds, and this is the anal fold. So initially there is connection, but later there will be formation of septum which separates these two folds, the urethral folds from the anal folds. And as you can see in this picture, there will be formation of one more elevation on either side of the urethral folds. So those elevation which are represented yellow in color in this picture, so that pair of elevation, another pair of elevation, is called as genital swellings, also called as labioscrotal swelling. So why it is called as labioscrotal swelling? Because it gives contribution to formation of labia majora in females, and in males it forms the, it develops into scrotum. So these appear on either side of the urethral fold. So this is a picture showing, so GT represents the genital tubercle, the fusion of urethral folds at the cranial aspect. Here you can see the urethral folds. This is the anal fold which is surrounded around the anal orifice, and this is the one more swelling on either side which is visible. So that's called as the labioscrotal swelling or the genital swelling. So this is an indifferent stage where the morphologically the fetus cannot be distinguished into male or a female. So let us know how a male external genital system will develop. As I mentioned that during 7th week of intrauterine life, so once the primordial germ cells, so they migrate to the intermediate mesoderm. You know that intermediate mesoderm is the part of the mesoderm. There will be three areas, that is the paraaxial, intermediate and lateral mesoderm. So intermediate mesoderm, the mesenchymal cells mainly contributes in the development of urogenital system. So there will be formation of gonadal ridge. So at that particular area, the primordial germ cells migrate. So once the primordial germ cells migrate, depending upon the chromosomes which is carried, the sex chromosomes carried by those germ cells will further differentiate to form either a male or a female gonad. So if it is a XY chromosome, so there will be formation of testis, and during 8th week of intrauterine life, there will be secretion of testosterone. So due to the androgen secreted by the fetal testis, so this will influence in the further differentiation of the external genitalia. So it will be indifferent stage. So once there is the secretion of testosterone, there will be the indifferent stage of the external genitalia will later further develop into male external genitalia. So what happens? So in indifferent stage, you had seen these structures. One is the genital tubercle, the urethral fold. This is the urethral groove, the cloacal membrane. Later here, there will be formation of a groove here. That's called as urethral groove that will form the urethra. Okay. And there will be formation of one more swelling, which is called as the genital swelling or labioscrotal swelling. So this is in the indifferent stage. So once there is influence from the testosterone, so there will be further lengthening and the development of the genital tubercle. So what happens? The genital tubercle elongates, and once it elongates, that structure will be called as phallus. Okay, and once the elongation of the genital tubercle takes place, it also elongates, it pulls and elongates the urethral fold, which forms the lateral wall of this groove. Okay, so you can see here now the cloacal membrane has been separated, and the folds also have been separated. As I mentioned, these they are separated by a septum. Okay, that's called as urorectal septum. So the urethral fold will form the lateral wall of this groove, urethral groove, and once there is elongation of the phallus, there will be also elongation and the pulling of the urethral fold, which forms the lateral wall of the urethral groove. So this urethral groove, as I mentioned, it is mainly from the cloacal membrane. So it mainly has the endodermal lining. Okay, so it has the epithelial lining, which is called as the urethral plate. So if you take a section at this area, so you can see the picture over here. Okay, so this is the fold. The orange one represents the fold, and you can see here this black color is the urethral plate, that is the epithelial lining of the urethral groove, which is endodermin origin. Okay, because cloacal membrane just has the ectoderm and the endoderm. Endoderm is the inner lining, so you'll be seeing the endoderm lining here. The urethral folds, on further elongation, they slowly starts fusing. So you can see here they fuse, they close over the urethral plate. So this is the urethral plate, the epithelial lining, which is endoderm. So the as further development takes place, the urethral fold closes over, it fuses over the urethral plate, and this forms the lumen of the penile urethra. So you know that the males have a longer urethra, so that is divided into three parts: prostatic, membranous, and the penile urethra. Among the three, the spongy or the penile urethra is the longest. Okay, so this forms the contributes to the formation of penile urethra. And this canal, so there's an opening, right? So the canal of the penile urethra, it extends only till the tip of the, that means if you can see here, this is the urethral groove, and this forms a lumen. Once the fold fuses, so it forms a canal. So this penile, the canal of the penile urethra, just extends only till the base of this phallus. So it doesn't extend till the tip of the phallus. So it, the canal is canal of the penile urethra, that is the endoderm contribution, it's only till the base of the phallus. So if you see the spongy part of the urethra, it has contribution both from the endoderm and also from the ectoderm. So the endoderm contribution is only till the base of the phallus. So this part of the phallus, after elongation, so it mainly forms the glans penis. Oh. So there the urethra, which is extending into the glans penis, the contribution is from the ectoderm. So just remember now, the canal, the penile urethra, does not extend till the tip of the phallus, so it only extends till the base of the phallus. So you can see here this is the urethral folds. You can see this is the phallus part, and the penile, the canal of the penile urethra, it is only extending till the base. So the most distal portion, so this is the distal portion of the urethra, of the spongy urethra, it is formed during the fourth month mainly by the ectodermal cells, which are present at the tip of the glans penis. Okay, so at the tip of the glans penis, some of the ectodermal cells, they they migrate inward, okay, and later they form, the lumen is formed. So the spongy part of the urethra which is present within the glans penis is mainly from the ectoderm. So it is ectodermal in origin. So that forms the opening will be called as the external urethral meatus. Then the genital swelling on either side of the genital, the urethral fold, there was a swelling which is called as a genital swelling. Since it has the influence from the androgen, that is the testosterone, so these genital swelling further develop into scrotum. Okay, so they form the scrotal swellings. Okay, so half of the scrotum. So this scrotum externally they fuse, but they are separated internally by a septum called as scrotal septum. The corpora cavernosa, so if you take a section of the penis, it has corpora cavernosa and corpora spongiosum. So they are all mainly contributed from the mesenchyme. Okay, so but the urethra, the penile urethra part, the spongy part, it's mainly contributed by the endoderm. The entire part is endoderm, but the part of the spongy urethra within the glans penis is mainly contributed by the ectoderm. So here you can see the folds have been, the urethral folds, they have been fused. So the normal anatomical position of the penis is the erected penis. Okay, so the inferior aspect is the ventral part, and the dorsal aspect is the superior part. So the erected penis is the normal anatomical position. So this is the erected penis. So you can see this is the ventral aspect of the penis, and the other part is the dorsal aspect. So here you can see the fusion of the urethral folds which are covering the penile urethra, and here you can see the formation of the scrotal swelling. So they have fused here too, in the externally, but internally they are separated by a scrotal septum. So this is the anal fold around the anus, the anal orifice. Okay, and the phallus part, the most distal phallus part, will form the glans penis, and you can see here is the external urethral meatus, which is mainly contributed by the ectodermal cells. So once again, I would like to repeat the development of spongy urethra. So up to the base of the glans penis, it develops from the endoderm of the phallic part of the urogenital sinus. So the primitive urethral orifice is formed near the base of the glans penis, because you can see the spongy urethra, which is contributed from the endoderm, which is originated from the endoderm. So they are formed at the base of the glans penis. So that is the primitive urethral orifice. Later, the urethra which is formed within the glans penis, okay, so that is the permanent urethral orifice. So this is just a primitive. So once there is ectodermal ingrowth, this is ectodermal cells migrate in inward. So they form a groove and they gradually fuse, and then the canal is formed. So that part of the urethra which is present within the glans penis is mainly contributed by the ectoderm. And if you can see at the tip of the glans penis, there will be opening. So that is called as the external urethral orifice, and that is the permanent urethral orifice. So this you have to remember, it's very important. Spongy urethra contribution is both from the endoderm and also from the ectoderm. Now coming to the external genitalia in females. So if there are no androgen, the testosterone, if there is development of female gonad, the ovaries, so definitely ovaries will secrete estrogen. So under the influence of estrogen, so there will be further development of the indifferent external genitalia. So when you can see the genital tubercle, there won't be more elongation, so there will be slight enlargement of this genital tubercle, but in males it elongated further to form the penis and the glans penis. So here the genital tubercle does not elongate, so there will be slight enlargement, and this forms the clitoris. Then the urethral fold in the female does not fuse, okay, they don't close, they don't fuse, and that forms the labia minora. And the genital swelling enlarge on either side, even they won't fuse, okay, and that forms the labia majora. And the groove which was present here at the center, that is the cloacal membrane which forms the urogenital groove, so this forms the vestibule. So why it is called as urogenital? Because in the vestibule you can see here there'll be opening of the urethra, okay, and also there'll be opening of the vagina, okay. So this part is called as a vestibule, where you can see two orifices, that is the urethral orifice and also vaginal orifice, okay. So this is the difference in male and female external genitalia. So this picture also shows the differentiation. So here this is in males, so there will be further elongation of the phallus, there will be fusion of the urethral folds, there will be fusion of the genital swelling, okay. But here in the females there won't be fewer, there'll be just enlargement of the genital tubercle to form clitoris. There is no fusion of urethral folds and even the genital swelling. So the urethral fold will form the labia minora, genital swelling will form the labia majora, and the groove forms the vestibule, where there'll be opening of, there'll be two orifices. One is the urethral orifice, which is anteriorly, and vaginal orifice posteriorly. So let us know about the descent of the testis. During the end of second month of intrauterine life, so here you can see the mesentery, the urogenital mesentery, which is attached to the gonads and to the mesonephros. So there will be layer of mesentery, so which attaches the developing gonad and the mesonephros to the posterior abdominal wall. So once the part of the mesonephros degenerates, so that forms the peritoneum lining of the gonad, okay. Increase in the intra-abdominal pressure, and also the influence from the androgen secreted by the testis, and also a substance called as Mullerian inhibiting substances, which is mainly secreted by the Sertoli cells. So the due to the influence of these factors, so there will be slowly descent of the testis, so which is mainly influenced by a ligament and a mesenchymal structure called as gubernaculum. So you here you can see, so the caudal part of this mesentery, okay, so from the caudal end of the testis, fetal testis, okay, and this part will form a ligamentous structure which is called as a genital ligament, and there will be mesenchymal matrix which will be called as a gubernaculum. So this is the intra-abdominal gubernaculum along with the genital ligament, okay. So they extend till the inguinal region. So as the testis starts descending, there will be a growth of gubernaculum at the extra abdominal area. So this is the intra abdominal gubernaculum. As the testis starts descending, so there will be formation of one more gubernaculum extra abdominally, which directs the testis towards the scrotum. So once the testis descends, so it reaches the inguinal region at around 12 to 13 weeks of gestation. Then it passes through the inguinal canal, okay. So it passes through the inguinal canal at around 28 weeks of gestation, and it reaches the scrotum at around 32 to 33 weeks of gestation. Here in this picture you can see the descent. So it has reached the inguinal region. So later it passes through the inguinal canal, which is between the internal inguinal ring and the external inguinal ring, also called as deep and superficial inguinal rings. Okay, so this is the inguinal canal, and by 33 weeks of gestation the testis will come to the scrotal area. The factors I've already mentioned: increased in intra-abdominal pressure, gubernaculum, okay, also, and the hormones includes the testosterone and the Mullerian inhibiting substance. So what is gubernaculum? Gubernaculum is just a mesenchymal condensation. So it passes through the inguinal canal and mainly terminates in the scrotal area. So here you can see here, okay. So it mainly helps, guides the testis so that it reaches the scrotum. So along with that, you can see the peritoneal layer. Okay, so the peritoneal layer, so there will be, along with the testis, there will be descent of, or the evagination of the peritoneal layer. So that evagination of the mesentery will be called as, that part is called as the processus vaginalis. Okay, so this is the structure, this is the layer of the mesentery. So along with the descent of the testis, there will be evagination of the processus vaginalis. So that also extends, and while it is passing through the inguinal canal, so there will be evagination of the abdominal layers as well. That is mainly the external abdominis, internal abdominis muscle, and fascia transversalis. So along with the processus vaginalis, there will be evagination of the muscular layer and the facial layers of the abdominal wall. So that also descends along with the testis. So once the testis reaches the scrotum, the processus vaginalis and the other muscular and the facial layer will ensheath around the testis. So here you can see, this is the processus vaginalis. So it covers around the testis. So they form the visceral and the parietal layer of tunica vaginalis. So the later they differentiate to form tunica vaginalis. So they have two layers. One is near to the ensheathing the testis. So that's called as the visceral layer. The other part is the parietal layer. So parietal and the visceral layer of tunica vaginalis. The other layers, the muscular and the facial layer, will form the external spermatic fascia, internal spermatic fascia, the cremastric muscle layer. So they all are contributed by the muscular and the facial layers of the abdominal wall. Like if you see, the internal abdominis muscle will form the cremastric muscle and the cremastric fascia. The fascia transversalis will form the internal spermatic fascia, and the external abdominal layers will the abdominis muscle will form the external spermatic fascia. The processus vaginalis, which is extending from the cranial part of the testis till the abdominal area, so that gets degenerated. So this is the passageway. Okay, so this means the process, this part of the cranial most or the proximal part of the processus vaginalis will degenerate. Only the distal part remains, to which forms the covering around the testis, that is the tunica vaginalis. The rest, the proximal part, has to degenerate. So if the processus vaginalis, so you, here you can see the connection between the peritoneal cavity and the tunica vaginalis. So this is the passageway through which the processus vaginalis has come through. So this is the connection. So this has to degenerate. But if it persists, if it does not degenerate, and if it remains, so that leads to a condition called as congenital inguinal hernia. So usually the proximal part of the processus vaginalis degenerates by first month of after birth, the postnatal. Within that they will degenerate. But if it remains, so that there will be abnormal protrusion of the coils of intestine into this connection. So that leads to a condition called as congenital indirect inguinal hernia. Sometimes what happens, the degeneration is incomplete, okay, and there can be in between, it might persist, and that is called, that leads to a cyst formation, okay, either around the testis or around at the area of the spermatic cord. So that there will be fluid within the cyst. So that condition is called as hydrocele. Okay, so there will be encysted hydrocele of the cord. So if it is here around the cord, around the spermatic cord, okay, or around the testis. 97% of in male babies, the testis will descend by once they are born. So the, as I mentioned, by 33 weeks of gestation, the testis will come to the scrotum area. But in few, it might occur later after birth, by within the third month of postnatal life. But sometimes in few male fetus, the testis won't descend completely. Okay, so that condition is called as cryptorchidism. So the most undescended testis during the birth returns to scrotum within first 3 months of life. But if there is no descent occurs after 1 year of life. So that condition is called as cryptorchidism. So which sometimes the descent might be incomplete, or it might totally undescend. It might be in the posterior abdominal wall, or sometimes the descent has occurred but it is incomplete, might remain at the inguinal region area. So that's called as undescended testis, and the condition is called as cryptorchidism, which can be corrected surgically. So if it is not descended, it might it will mainly affect in the secretion of spermatozoa, the formation of spermatozoa, because the maintenance of the temperature is very, very important for the process of spermatogenesis, because in the abdominal area the pressure is, the intra-abdominal pressure is, the temperature is more, intra-abdominal pressure is more when compared to scrotum. So the temperature around within the scrotum is lesser when compared to the abdominal temperature. So for the process of spermatogenesis, so the temperature is very, very important. So if the testis is undescended and if it remains in the abdominal region or the inguinal region, so this might affect the spermatogenesis. What about the ovary, the female gonad, that's the ovary? So there is a descent of the ovary, but not as you see in the males. So primitive ovary will be at the dorsal abdominal wall, but it descends at the level of the rim of the true pelvis. Okay, so the descent is only halfway through. So it is also guided by gubernaculum, but if you see the gubernaculum, the will later form the ligament of ovary and round ligament of uterus. So gubernaculum, the cranial part of the gubernaculum will form the suspensory ligament of ovary, and the caudal part of the gubernaculum will give contribution to the ligament of ovary and the round ligament of uterus. Okay, so this round ligament of uterus is attached distally to the labia majora. So the processes vaginalis also degenerate a part of the evagination of the mesentery, but if it persists, it can persistence of the processes vaginalis in female is called as canal of Nuck. If the testis also descends to the abnormal position, so that's also called as ectopic testis. Other clinical applications or consideria related to external genitalia is hypospadiasis, epispadiasis. About double uterus and vagina, I have already dealt in my other video on development of female reproductive system. There can be disorders of the sexual development as well. Okay, undescended testis is called as a cryptorchidism, which I have already spoken about that. Congenital inguinal hernia, hydrocele of the testis. Okay, so what do you mean by hypospadiasis and epispadiasis? So as you know that the urethral fold around the urethral groove, so they fuse around the urethral plate, which later forms the penile urethra. So if there is no fusion, if there is incomplete fusion of the urethral fold, so that leads to a condition called as hypospadiasis. So external urethral orifice is on the ventral surface of the glans penis. Okay, so the penis is underdeveloped here, so you can see there can be abnormal urethral orifices on the ventral aspect of the penis due to the incomplete closure or the fusion of urethral folds. So this condition is called as hypospadiasis, which is very common in male fetus. What do you mean by epispadiasis, which is a rare anomaly? So where the external urethral orifice is on the dorsal surface of the penis, where this is the dorsal surface of the penis, so there is opening over here, the urine is expelled at the root of the penis. Okay, and there is opening, so this might be accompanied by the abnormality in the ventral abdominal wall, or sometimes there can be exostrophy of the bladder where the ventral aspect of the abdominal wall is not closed. Okay, so this condition is called as epispadiasis, where the opening orifice opening can be seen on the dorsal aspect of the penis, so which is a rare anomaly. Since the sexual development of male and female begins in an identical fashion, So the abnormalities of the development is very common. So there can be disorders of the sexual development. So that condition, some ambiguous genitalia, where a female fetus or a female baby can have a large clitoris, like clitoris hypertrophy can have. In a male baby, there can be a small penis, a micro penis. So this can occur, the abnormalities can occur. So sometimes what happens, there can be mismatch between the genotype and the phenotype. Genotype is chromosomal factors doesn't match with the physical appearance. So this can also can occur. So this are some of the disorders of the sexual development. Sometimes it can be due to biochemical abnormalities. There's a condition called as congenital adrenal hyperplasia. So this can result in the abnormalities in the sexual characters, in the sexual development. And there's also one more condition called as androgen insensitivity syndrome, where the chromosome is XY. Okay, there is development of testis, but the androgen secreted by the testis is not it is not influencing in the development of the external genitalia, which can be due to lack of androgen receptors in the tissues. So there can be sexual abnormalities. Okay, so these are some of the clinical conditions related to the development of external genitalia. So that completes the development of external genitalia in male and female. This is my reference, the Langmann's Medical Embryology. Thank you for watching.